Jesus comes tomorrow. It's laying on the table. If Jesus comes tomorrow, it's laying right there on the table where the discs are.
Coming one day. We don't know the day, the hour, the minute, nothing, but we need to be ready. Amen. For he said, in an hour you think not, the Son of Man coming. What a blessing it is to look forward to that. Whether we go to him or he comes for us, whichever. What a blessing that is. I spoke this past Wednesday night, those of you that were here, briefly about the questions that Jesus proposed or gave to Peter. I believe God is speaking to hearts all over this nation today. I believe God's asking the question, who do you love? Do you love me? Do you love my church? Do you love my people? All of these questions are questions that I believe the Holy Spirit is taking and applying in our lives every day. But I want to touch on this briefly today, these two questions that Jesus directed directly to Peter. Out of all the disciples, the Lord did this for Peter. Now we know that there are some things that we'll never understand till we get to heaven. And so no need in trying to figure it out. Unless God shows it to us, we'll end up that way. Amen. But two questions that he asked Peter, but who do men say that I am? As you look around and think about this today, thinking about his response to what Jesus had just said, we can look in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verses, I'm not going to read all these, 4 through 10, but I want you to know that he said that we as Christians are to be like newborn babies. We're to desire the sincere milk of the Word of God. But then there's a time in our life when we get off the milk and onto the meat. Amen. I mean, it'd be a sad state of affairs to look over the congregation and everybody sitting here trying to drink milk. We need to have the meat out of God's Word as Christians desiring that. Then he asked him this question, and you find this in John's Gospel, chapter 21. He said, lovest me more than these? Two questions that are still relevant today in the life that you and I live, although they were directed to Peter, and I'm going to tell you why here in just a little while, if you'll bear with me. If you were to look in the Scriptures, for instance, let's look in the book of Matthew chapter 16. If you want to turn with me or if you just want to listen, whichever you prefer to do. But as we look at this in Matthew 16, he said these words in verses 15 through 18. He saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter, notice, he used his old name. He used his old name. Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bojan, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. As we looked at that, we see as Peter responded to him, and in first you realize that he used his old name. And then when he recognized who he was as far as stating the fact, he said, thou art Peter, and upon this I'll build my church. Upon this rock I'll build my church. So we see that there. And then if you want to turn over to John chapter 21, and we'll read a scripture there to answer these two questions that the Lord presented to Peter. And it's important for us today. Those two questions are as real today as they were then. Amen. Amen. So we see today in this, John 21, verses 15 through 17. So when they had dined, Jesus said unto Simon Peter, here we go again, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He said unto him, feed my lambs. And he said unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, recognizing who he was, but called him by his old name. He said unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas. He didn't say Peter. He used that name. Notice that. Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? Takes God some time to get our attention, doesn't it? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus said unto him, Feed my sheep. Father, I pray now as we read these scriptures in the hearing of each one, may you use it, Lord, and bring it forth as only you can, that we might see our names, our picture, our needs, our desires within this today. If it's nothing but words from the preacher's mouth, it'll do no effect. But Lord, may it be led by the Spirit of God, not only in the speaking, but in the hearing. Bless and have your way, Father, for we ask it in Jesus' name. God's people said, Amen. This scene here, as it indicates to us, it tells us something about these disciples, and especially Peter. If you and I today, at this stage of his life, let's just say it that way, at this point in his life, Jesus had a desire to get a hold of Peter. He didn't want to just know him. He wanted to get a hold of him. I wonder how many folks today, God still has that same desire, wants just to get a hold of him. If God can get a hold of you, he'll use you. Amen. It's like the potter with the clay. The choir sang that song a while ago. And if you look over in Jeremiah, the 20th chapter, 18th chapter, you'll find that it talks about that. But I'm saying today that God wants to do for us like he did for Peter. You see, at this point in his life, Peter got tired of waiting. And if you recall what he said in John chapter 20, he said, Boys, I'm going fishing. You remember that? Read your Bible. You've read that. And there was those that went with him. What would you say about that today? I'd say he was out of the will of God's what I'd say. He walked away from God. He did that because he did what he wanted to do rather than what God wants to do. That's the problem with churches today. Instead of doing what God would have us to do, we want to do what we want to do. We don't seek God. We don't search for God. We don't look for the truth. We are just as in the same shape, in the same stage in our life as Peter was, and he was going back to the business that he had before. I'm going fishing. Listen, but those who have put their hand upon the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, those who have received unto themselves and God has blessed them, they have a desire to want to please God. Not self, but God. Amen. If you want to see a church thrive, you place it in God's hands. Get your hand off of it. Turn it loose. Tell God, this is His. It's bought, paid for by the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. It don't belong to me. It don't belong to anybody else. It's His church. It belongs to Him. We're to take our direction from Him. Amen. So we see that. You see that sacred call when God said, Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. In Matthew 11, 28, 29. So we know that if we follow Him, life's going to be a lot better. Amen. If anybody's going to worry, let God do the worry. Don't worry about it. God will take care of it. You can't handle it. You ain't big enough to handle it. And neither am I. But God is big enough to handle it. So we see those who have laid their hands to the plow that the Bible describes, Don't look back. Don't look back. Look to the other end of the field. I remember the first time that Dad took me out to the field, and he said, I want you to plow this field. He didn't say anything else to me, and I got on the tractor, and I thought, I can handle this. And I dropped them plows in the ground, and I started off, and I'd look back at them plows. I'd go a little further, and I'd look back. And when I got to the other end of that field, that row went just like this. And Dad, I came back. I thought he was going to say, well, that's good for a start. Huh? Some of you frown and you ought to smile. Anyhow, that's good for a start. And my dad said, look to the other end and don't look back. And I took his advice, looked to the other end. That row was as straight as it could be. I want to tell you, that's the way it is with Christian life. I don't look back, I look forward. Amen. So I say this today with all respect to everyone that's present. The Lord met Peter and gave him an opportunity for a fresh communion with God. There's people today may be listening by the media. You need to get a fresh start with God. Amen. You need to ask yourselves the questions that Jesus asked Peter. Do you love me? What do people say about me? You know, the life we live is what we believe. Amen. Faith. You know, I remember hearing a preacher, he was elderly at the time, I was young, and he said, your faith will show in the way you live, not in what you say. I remember hearing a good friend of mine telling a gentleman in the church one time, he was one of these that always had something he had to say. And he looked at him and laid his hand on his shoulder and he said, I can't hear what you're saying for seeing what you're doing. And brother, today the world's looking at us and they're trying to evaluate what this church and other churches just like it are all about. We need a spiritual revival that'll awaken not only this church but other churches of like faith and bring them back into a new communion with the Lord Jesus Christ. Not just talking about him, not just asking for things, but living a life that's pleasing unto God. Amen. Putting everything about us in his hands. Amen. And saying, God, here am I. Send me. Isaiah said in the 6th chapter of the book of Isaiah, he said, woe is me, for I am a man of unclean lips and I dwell among a people. They are sinful. And God said, who shall I send? Isaiah seen himself as God seen him. And he said, send me, Lord. I'll go for you. God sees us as we are, not as what we want to be or present to somebody else, but God sees us as we are. So what did he do here? This is my thought about this. He gave him a fresh start. If you remember, Peter had denied him. Peter had stood by the fires of the enemy and said, no, not me. But then you see that here, when the Lord faced him, and if you read these two chapters and the chapters before and after what I gave you, you'll see that even out of the Lord's will, here he was out there in the boat, and Jesus come unto him and said, children, have you caught any fish? And the Lord spoke to him those words. You know what? He's saying the same thing to me as a preacher. Have you caught any fish? He's saying that to us as a church. Have you caught any fish? God's been good to us. The miracle catch of fish, you can see how that he declared and declined. This is it. He stood by the fire and the coals of the enemy. He denied the Lord 3 times. His vain boast that he made, the use of an old name Simon, as Jesus referred to him, indicated the old man, not a new man. Now we look at how the Lord rekindled what was inside of Peter that had become dormant. Okay? Let's look at it. He said, do you love me? Do thou love me? Lovest thou me? Pretty straight question, huh? Well, he asked his church today the same question. He said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Amen. And if you love me, you'll go out and preach this gospel and teach others about the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Peter made this statement. I love you. I mean, it's just that simple. He said, I love thee. Ask him again. Peter, lovest thou me? This is speaking about the agape love, the godly love, which only God can produce in our lives. Amen? Religion will never bring it to you. There's a lot of folks that's got religion. When they stand before God, he's going to say, depart from me. I never knew you. It's going to be a sad state of affairs. I know this is a very direct message, but I believe the church needs to wake up. Christians need to realize what God has got for us, that we're falling far below the mark, and turn it over to God and let the church be God's. Amen. And we be his servants. Lovest thou me? He said these words to him, lovest thou me? And so he said these words in a way to where Peter could understand them. Peter said, I love thee. Thou knowest that I know all things. In other words, he knows us today. That's what Peter's saying. He knows me. He knows you. He knows all there is to know about us. And I'm going to mention three very, very short, very quick ways by which that it showed in his life that he never went back to the old life again. He had put his hand in the hand of the Lord and said, Lord, thou knowest all things. How the Lord reshaped Peter's future. He gave Peter the opportunity to speak in 2nd chapter of the book of Acts. And he said to them, he that you have crucified by your own hands has God raised from the dead and has ascended into the heavens. But it doesn't stop there. This same Jesus shall return again in the clouds with the glory. I want to tell you today a privilege of being a shepherd today, an under-shepherd for the Lord, means a great deal to me. For 50 years, that became more prevalent to me than anything in my life. I've been there when I was needed. I preached what God laid on my heart. I'll not have to back up when I get to the gates of glory. But I'll look for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he's going to say, well done. I want to hear him say that to you. That's my heart's desire today, is to hear him say that to you. Well done. Then next of all, the privilege or the price of being a shepherd. It comes at a high price. There are a lot of things in the world that you cannot do, a lot of places you cannot go. There are a lot of things that you cannot participate in. It's got a price. It's got a price. And last of all, the principle of being a shepherd is, first of all, you've got to know the sheep, and then you've got to know the great shepherd, which can lead you into all truths. And by knowing these three facts in your life, it can change everything about you if you're willing to let God do it. Amen? Amen. It's one of those things that God wants to speak to his church. Amen. Amen. There are folks that are listening to this today through the internet, through all these medias that it goes out. And many of them have gone back to the old life. But there's no peace, no happiness, no joy there. They're just existing. Beloved, today God will give you a new communion with Him if you're willing to accept it and do it God's way and not man's way. That's what will make the difference in any church. Following God, He'll draw people to Him. I hope it's been a blessing to you today. I know it's not been very long. And I can go on if you want me to. One amen in the house, all over your couch. You ought to call my hand. I'd have said, I don't have nothing. I'm done. But anyhow, that's what God laid on my heart this past week. And I've tried to share it with you. What do people say about Him? He said, on this rock I'll build my church. What are people saying about this church? That's what you've got to think about. And how do we love Him? Do we love Him with just this much or this much? Do we give Him everything and say, God, there it is. I take my hands off of it. It's yours. And you do it as you please. Let's stand. We'll be dismissed.